The exhilaration of finding a fossil is replicated in few other pursuits. Though hunting meteorites, mushrooms, veins of valuable ore in mines, and so on do compare. Picking out something from the local environment that is unusual often requires a trained eye. I remember long ago at an early age, must have been around 1981 or 82, finding fossilized crinoid stems on a clay-rich Midwestern hilltop. They were colloquially known as Indian beads, which the Native Americans of the Mississippi Valley's woodland period about 2 millennia ago did in fact notice and use them as such, as shown in archaeological sites. These ancient objects very much predate humans, though there are still existing species of crinoid. Less than there used to be, but they are still with us, and are often known as sea lilies. The ones a very young JMG was finding were from the Mississippian period, when an inland sea covered the area around 360 to 320 million years ago. I don't know what I thought they were at age 6 or 7. I suspect that I had been told they were fossils. But one wonders what the ancient Native Americans thought they were when they'd find these strange coherent structures eroding out of the ground. There are, however, preserved folktales from Europe and Asia that do record some of humanity's interactions with fossils. One such tale comes from Austria, though variations of it can be found across Europe. It's known as the Lindworm, and it's basically a dragon with heavily giant snake-like connotations rather than wings, at least in some versions. They could be good or bad, and were often associated with increasing whatever they happen to be laying on top of. This led to more modern takes like J.R.R. Tolkien's The Hobbit, where Smaug the Dragon sat greedily atop a pile of gold stolen from the dwarves. In the actual folktale though, or variations of it, the dragon would have simply been collecting interest by laying on what probably started as a few bits and pieces of gold, amassing a huge treasure as it just sat there in the ultimate in passive income sources. Try to get that gold, however, and apparently the mythical dragon would swallow its own tail, thereby turning itself into a giant rolling wheel coming straight at you. Not good. That said, in Klagenfurt, Austria, a 16th century fountain sports a depiction of a lindworm, whose head is thought to have been based on the skull of a woolly rhinoceros found in a quarry nearby in 1335. It's often been cited as the earliest reconstruction of an extinct animal known, though it's likely that people finding fossil skulls throughout human history tried to imagine what they found, what it might have looked like, especially if it resembled no skull of any animal that they had ever hunted. Today we know much more about just how to interpret fossils that come out of the ground. We can reconstruct dinosaurs, though the interpretation of dinosaur fossils is fluid to be sure. In my lifetime, I've seen the interpretation of some members of the tyrannosaurs go from plodding, slow reptiles dragging their tails waiting for the asteroid, to hot-blooded, fast, dynamic apex predators with stereo vision, and in some cases feathers, very much showing their connections to the birds of today. And that can change again. New fossils are found all the time that add and adjust our knowledge of past life on this world. But imagine for a moment the cataclysm that ended the age of the dinosaurs, the great end Cretaceous asteroid impact. That object hit with such force as to send massive amounts of the ocean floor and its bedrock essentially into space, much of which would fall back down to Earth, some in the form of a rain of molten glass spherules, but some might have made it into interplanetary space. If some of that made it through the impact and into space relatively intact, it's possible that fossil-bearing rocks from Earth exist floating around out there somewhere in the solar system, or perhaps deposited on the surface of the moon. It's not entirely implausible that traces of Earth's crinoid fossils may be sitting on the surface of the moon after having been blasted off. It might even be possible that an impact on Earth threw a large enough chunk of material into space only to impact and create a crater on the moon, though not likely any of the really big ones. Look to the asteroids in the outer solar system comets for those kinds of masses to create sizable lunar craters. But over the decades since the mid-20th century, there has been the idea that life, or traces of it, might be transferable from body to body in a solar system, or even on an interstellar basis. This is of course panspermia, where life itself is transferred as impacts cause the planets of a system to sneeze inhabited rocks on each other. But there are other options for a lesser form of that idea. For example, we strongly suspect that the building blocks of life in the form of amino acids were delivered to Earth by meteorites. Why? Because we find amino acids in meteorites today of certain classes. But that's just the building blocks, not something made by biology itself. We have never seen life itself inside a meteorite, but it is in principle possible for fossilized life to sit quietly inside a meteorite in one form or another, protected, and evidence of past life somewhere else might get deposited on Earth. There has been a candidate for this, but so far, it hasn't panned out. This, of course, was the Allen Hills 84001 Martian meteorite, recovered in Antarctica, where in 1996, purported microfossils were reported. But as time went on, the scientific community came up with more mundane explanations for the structures seen in the meteorite. Part of the problem with these purported fossils was that they were much smaller than somewhat similar traces on Earth that are linked to biology. And while the question of past microbial life on Mars remains absolutely open, we simply don't know the answer to the question, this particular meteorite was not a slam dunk on the matter. NASA and other organizations now look for that slam dunk, if it's possible, but establishing as many of the ground rules as possible for the discovery of evidence of past life on Mars, which the goal is to ultimately try to have as much data as possible about the environments and conditions as to make any actual discovery of direct evidence unambiguous. The lessons of past life detection experiments, including the Allen Hills meteorite, but also the labeled release experiment on the Viking landers giving a positive, both then going on into dispute, are well learned. You must be on 100% solid ground to convince the scientific community of such a momentous discovery. At the same time, however, there's no reason not to suspect Mars, or for that matter Venus, might have spawned life in a similar way that Earth did. They both seem to have once had the conditions. It's just that the case for life has to be rock solid. A sedimentary rock from Mars, which does have them, with a fossil in it, would do the trick. And they're in the beginnings of sample return missions sitting on Mars right now, preparing samples that might someday be retrieved and searched for such fossils. But what if further searches of the meteorites that fall on Earth? Well, the problem there is that few meteorite classes other than some of the Martian ones that have small amounts of clay deposited in their fissures offer much promise. It breaks down like this. The iron-nickel meteorites can tell you a lot about the formation of protoplanet cores during the early days of the solar system, and indeed about iron asteroids that lurk out there, rich in valuable metals not very common on Earth, such as iridium. Stony iron meteorites tell you about transitional areas, mantles of shattered objects where stone and iron meet, often in beautiful lattices of iron, nickel, and green translucent olivine crystals. And finally, there are the stone meteorites, the vast majority being chondrites that preserve, in the form of chondrules, the very grains and materials that the solar system formed out of, often subject to varying degrees of shock. Some of this is pristine, like some of the carbonaceous chondrites that contain amino acids, but are still almost unaltered material from the very beginning of the solar system, sometimes even containing interstellar grains predating the solar system itself. But the idea of planets spreading materials that contain fossils, and perhaps discovering them here on Earth, has recently deepened. In a paper by Tominori Totani, link in the description below, it is detailed that it's possible that sub-micron-sized fossils, or minerals associated with life, might be found in interstellar dust that had originated on inhabited worlds. This is an interesting proposition indeed, because this world sees a constant rain of micrometeoroids, many tons per year, that do make it to the surface. And it's always been that way, across the planet's entire history. It's worth noting again here that this approach involves searching for long-dead fossils or mineral traces left by life. It does not include the standard panspermic living life idea, making it far more viable as a method of biosignature detection. Indeed, it could be better than optical or radio astronomy, which are very difficult as far as detecting bio or techno signatures. Much gets lost in the distance and the noise of the universe, and while both remain possibilities, they aren't going to compete with actual samples of interstellar materials collected here on Earth. The study of micrometeoroids is already underway. There are specialists that collect them from such places as rooftops of buildings using various techniques. In fact, it used to be a thing within amateur astronomy to set up pans of water to collect them, especially if they were magnetic, because the rain of these things is constant. While they don't often survive passage through the atmosphere, such as those involved with familiar meteor showers originating from comets, some material does survive. And as the recent discovery of two highly probable meteorite falls of interstellar hyperbolic trajectory origin show, there is definitely interstellar material originating from other star systems sitting here on Earth, maybe even some undiscovered in our meteorite collections. And some of that material may be from other habitable planets. Totani details two approaches for obtaining these kinds of materials so we can do a search. The first is obvious: collect the material in space. We've already done this with missions of similar intent. You basically launch a spacecraft with a block of aerogel in it, expose it to space for a time, and it will trap micrometeoroids that can be parachuted back to Earth. Not easy, but the concept is already proven through the return of cometary grains. The other method is much easier, at least for a large sample. Look for them on Earth. There are two possibilities here: Antarctica and the seafloor. Antarctica has long been known to have collection points. Meteorites fall on the ice and get buried by the snows. But the glaciers of Antarctica can act like conveyor belts that move anything contained within them to the point where the glaciers melt, essentially leaving piles of meteorites in the melting areas, either getting exposed during the melt or dumped outright almost in a pile. This should also be the case for micrometeoroids trapped in the glaciers as well. The seafloor, if in a relatively undisturbed state, would also serve as a collection area for micrometeoroids. But once you get a sample through any method, then you can start looking at composition, and more importantly, isotope ratios that should tell you if the particle originated in the solar system or is of an interstellar nature. Once you do that, you can begin the search for fossils or biologically related minerals, with presumably a very large sample of the Milky Way's terrestrial worlds. If you see something of interest, there you go, study it further. If you never see anything at all, then that may be every bit as revealing. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently a bit concerned about the Milky Way's planets sneezing on Earth. I'd say it's a bit rude, and we might consider some kind of sneeze guard like they have at the buffet restaurants. But then, Earth has been doing its share of sneezing as well. Not the most considerate planet, Earth, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.